And so we're clear about the order of argument in this case. The custom in this circuit is that when there are appeals and cross appeals, we have the first party, and they may reserve any amount of the time they want for rebuttal, and the second party then uses all of its time consecutively together. I understand that Mr. Moskin and Mr. Ciardello want to split time.
Right, Mr. Ciardello.
You need to be in charge of that. We won't be in charge of that for you.
I understand, and your bailiff kindly explained at the outset the practice here.
Okay, so, my one piece of advice is that it never works. but nonetheless, hope springs eternal, and I'll ask you to try to monitor your own splitting of time. With that, we're ready to begin.
Good morning, Your Honor. May it please the Court. My name is David Dillard, along with Sammy Schilly. We're from Lewis Rocha, Rothgerber, Christie, and we represent Blumenthal Distributing. I'd like to begin with some comments regarding functionality. This is a rather unusual appeal because the factual basis does not seem to be nearly as contested as the legal basis. We have challenges to what is reported in the Ninth Circuit cases to be the legal test for functionality in the circuit, and it's based on the traffic's decision in 2001. That particular decision clarified the landscape for functionality that was created by the prior Qualitex decision. That was a decision by the Supreme Court that involved color as a potential trademark. And the issue there was aesthetic functionality. And the Qualitex decision added a new prong to the then existing Inwood test. The Inwood test is a feature is functional if it's essential to the use or purpose of the article or affects the cost or quality of the article. The Qualitex case added a phrase that is something to the effect of whether protection of the feature as a trademark would impose significant non-reputation-related competitive disadvantage. So it added a competitive need test.
Did it add an additional test, or was it merely describing the purpose of the functionality test? See, I'm not sure that case imposed a separate independent test. What it seemed to be saying is that's the reason that we have a functionality test is so as not to lead to this result.
The traffic's case distinguish utilitarian functionality from aesthetic functionality.
Right, and this is not an aesthetic functionality.
This
case.
Is not an yes, and the traffic's case. Traffic's court said that the utilitarian functionality is determined by application of the Inwood test. Okay,
that's a case that yes. said we. That's why I keep going back to Inwood. What isn't the Inwood test the test we apply?
Exactly, it is. I was okay. getting to that. Yes.
So here, right. here, with respect to the Eames chair, you're happy with the result in the Aeron chair.
Yes.
With respect to the Eames chair, there was significant testimony that, for want of a better term, the curvy little bumps on the back of the Eames chair and its design really didn't add anything to its function. They were there to appeal to buyers because they like the shape, because they like the design. The jury didn't have to believe that testimony, but it did. If it does believe that, why doesn't it meet the Inwood test?
The jury wasn't confronted with testimony that little bumps on the back or this. It was that this component is non-functional.
No, that's not exactly what the expert said. He said this component adds nothing to the function of the chair. It is merely, it's merely something to attract buyers because they like the shape and design.
The problem is that Blumenthal, we had presented evidence as to each of the components of the trade dress, and for the
but
sake.
But you can have, right? You can have. Don't you agree that you can have a device made up of it, all functional components that nonetheless its trade dress in some respect may not be functional?
If all of the components are functional, then it doesn't qualify for trade dress. That's
like
a Letterman
your,
case.
It seems like under your interpretation, no product with a functional use could ever have trade dress.
That's.
Can you explain how that's not the case under your reading? Because that's sure. What it seems like when I read your brief.
Sure. Well, that's what you've been told. to be protectable, it's got to be non-functional. Your features have to be non-functional. There's plenty of cases that also.
So can you give an example? Like, what kind of product do you think would be possible to have trade dress that's a functional product, and under your way of breaking it apart into pieces, still not fail?
If you had an embellishment, something ornamental placed on the product just for the purpose of source identification.
Let's take the Coca-Cola bottle.
Mm-hmm.
It has a function. It keeps the soda inside. It has a cap on top of it. They're both functional. But
that's
the
true.
Bottle
yes.
The bottle has on it, the traditional old bottle, was designed in a sort of way so that people recognized it as Coke. So even though both of the components were functional, it was protectable as trade dress, was it not?
It was.
And so in this case, we have a chair, all of whose components work in functional ways, but the upper portion of the chair, if you will, which is the only part
right,
we're fighting
right.
about here, is designed in a sort of way so that when people look at it, they say, that's the Eames chair. I want an Eames chair. So why isn't that protected?
Because you've got all of the components are functional, even their witnesses.
That's true. My Coca-Cola bottle, too.
I think you were starting to answer my question by saying if there's a logo, then the logo can be trademarked. But that isn't, we know that that's not the only kind of thing that could be trademark protected. The trade dress is not about the Volkswagen logo. So what else?
Well, if for example, if you had taillights on a car, there are a lot of taillights that look very generic. But there are some taillights, I've noticed these once in a while, that have a unique curvature that is non-functional.
So then why don't we look at this chair and think, what a nice style, that's a unique curvature.
Well, but they've never presented evidence of what curvatures were non-functional. The trade dress was.
Well, I thought the expert said that the design of the back of the chair, if you will, adds nothing to its function. I think I've got a quote from him. He said it doesn't. That bit of design adds nothing to the function of the chair. Obviously, the chair needs a back, but the way it's designed doesn't add to the function at all.
Yeah, I think you may be talking about the upper spreader. There was.
The stuff that looks like this.
We have the web, a single piece of.
What? That's the Aeron chair.
Upholstery.
That's the Aeron chair.
No, that's the Eames chair. You have two rails,
right.
Kind of L-shaped rails, that are maintained a distance apart by a couple of spreaders.
Right.
And there's a web, a continuous seat back web that is. Strung between the two rails.
The fabric.
The upholstery, right.
And the expert seems to say that doesn't add anything to the function. He may be wrong. You put on your own expert. I'm just
the problem is that just saying this is non-functional without any evidence can't be substantial evidence that would support the jury verdict.
Well, but it doesn't see, that's why I'm focusing on his testimony. I think he says more. I think he says the chair would work as a chair equally well without that.
Yeah, that's
so that therefore it doesn't, it's not something that adds to the function of the chair. It's like the ribs on the Coke bottle. They don't add to the function of holding the Coke in. They just make it distinctive.
I think you're falling into this de facto de jure type of analysis. The Inwood analysis is, and let me suggest there's two alternatives to the Inwood analysis. The essential to the use or purpose of the article, that's the first, or affects the cost or quality. Okay, affecting the cost or quality is very broad, and it doesn't have anything to do with competitive need. If your features, you know, affect the cost or quality, then it's functional. Okay, it's very
but
simple,
quality,
but very broad.
Quality in that quote doesn't mean aesthetically pleasing, right?
No, it would not. It would not be ornamental.
Or look at that nice shape.
But the quality can be. Does it support the sling that's in between?
No, but I don't think so. I think the quality in this case is it a better chair? Does it function? Does the back of the chair function better because of that? And we know it may not. But we know the expert says no, it doesn't. These are decorative.
They don't.
The chair doesn't function any better because they are there. Indeed, we can look at the Aeron chair and determine that they're not necessary. They're decorative, aren't they? These webs.
Well,
what is their? Let me ask the question differently. What is their function in your
the web? Is what you sit in, and the rails and the web and the corner units all work together to provide a nice, comfortable seating.
But let me ask again: what is the function of the things
stripes.
That go the stripes?
What's the
function of the stripes?
The welds.
Yes.
Okay, the welds or the stitching.
Yeah.
Okay, that would be to maintain that there's cushion in between. You know, this is
I know that
cushion.
Was the position right. your side took, but the other side said.
No, that's.
The experts
the evidence
they
from them.
add nothing to the comfort of the chair.
I think they said that you could do it any way.
Right.
But that's just a speculation. You know, there was no other ways that they pointed to that would be just as good. So we're getting into your questions are suggesting that there's a competitive need for this, and if there isn't. Well,
but
you could have it.
I mean, this goes back, I think, to the first question Judge Hurwitz asked. Why isn't the competitive need question to help us figure out if it's necessary to the function? If lots of other people can make chairs other ways, then that shows it's not really a necessary function.
Okay, this is one of the, disc golf factors. You know, in applying the Inwood test, the Ninth Circuit has devised these disc golf factors, one of which is the availability of alternatives. And with respect to the availability of alternatives, the requirement is that the alternative must have all the same, and they talk about exactly the same functions as the chair in question. And this is, the leading cases are like Leatherman. In fact, Leatherman has a very good discussion of what's needed to be a alternative. Also, the Apple case, I'm sure it's addressed in a number of cases. This question about what is an alternative. Well, there were no alternatives that met that criteria.
That was debated by the two sides. I mean, their expert said, yes, there are. There are lots of ways you could do this.
And again, this is statement made without any evidence.
So then you cross-examine the expert and you say, well, what do you mean by that and what are you pointing to? I mean, I assume you had the opportunity to do that.
Yes.
And so then you convince the jury or not that the expert has a basis for saying there are lots of ways. I mean, you can undermine the expert by showing that the expert isn't talking about anything, but presumably you didn't do that because the jury agreed with them.
Sure, but this
Well, you're not arguing on appeal that the expert's testimony should have been excluded. That's the argument you should be making now, but that's not what your brief says. There's no argument on appeal that the trial court erred by admitting the testimony.
The fact that this is all speculative testimony is
so you move to strike it as speculative then, or you bring a Daubert motion? I mean, I don't understand how on appeal now we can say basically you're saying the expert should be disregarded, but that was not what I mean. You didn't try to strike the expert's testimony.
Perhaps I can ask you, because I think that wasn't the question. It was a statement, accurate statement. Can I address the Aeron chair for a moment? On the Aeron chair, why was the jury instruction that's being attacked correct? It seems to me that the instruction is at 25.
Yes.
I'm not sure 25 properly defined functionality. Could you tell me why you think it was correct?
Yes. I think I have it here just a moment. Oh, here we go.
The instruction said, right. If the feature is part of the actual benefit the customers wish to purchase when they buy the product, the feature is functional. And in automotive gold, we pretty squarely rejected that notion. So why is this instruction not error?
This tracks the Inwood test very closely. The Inwood test talks about a feature is functional if it affects the cost or quality of the article. And
it's like we're just getting back to the same. I think your answer is sort of the same thing we were talking about before, though. If someone buys the car because they like the shape of the headlights, then they're buying a feature that they wish to have. But under this jury instruction, it would fail. It would be functional, but you told me the headlights are not functional.
No, and that's a matter of the articulation of the trade dress.
Right.
Yeah. You know, if you're talking
this jury
about
instruction inconsistent with your headlight example.
In the headlight example, you would articulate the trade dress to be the specific curvatures and describe the curvatures that you're claiming are non-functional.
And if I buy that car because I say, look at those headlights, I really want that car, that's so cool, then I have the car and I bought it because of the headlights, right. And yet this jury instruction would tell me that makes it functional, but you're telling me it's not.
Well, okay, it is kind of splitting hairs, but you have a taillight. The fact that you have a taillight is functional. Okay, the particular, you know, points or shape of it is distinctive.
Right.
And it doesn't have to be in that shape. There would be, in that case, there would be plenty of plenty of alternatives that performed the exact same function.
Right. So if I bought the car because I liked the particular shape that's distinctive and doesn't matter to the function, it would seem like I'm buying the car because of that feature, and this jury instruction would tell me that makes it functional.
And in the Volkswagen case, we said that's wrong. It doesn't become functional simply because the buyer buys it for that reason.
Likes it. So I don't understand yet how you think your car example is consistent with this jury instruction.
Well, again, you can articulate trade dress, and you're supposed to identify the non-functional features, before you get into a lawsuit.
Let's just go back to my Coke bottle.
Sure.
Because it's easier for me. Look at this instruction. Somebody says, I bought Coke because I love that bottle. Does that make the bottle functional?
That doesn't make it functional.
No, but that's what this instruction says.
No,
this feature says, if the feature is part of the actual benefit that the consumers wish to purchase when they buy the product, the feature is functional.
Well,
that seems to say, if I want to get that Coke bottle because I like the way the bottles look, that makes the bottle functional.
No, this is for utilitarian functionality. With the Coke bottle, even that, you've got the little flutes or whatever. If you can make an argument that the shape of it makes it easier to hold, and so it's not so clear cut under today's standards that the Coke bottle would survive a challenge to utilitarian functionality.
We've taken you over time, but I'll give you a few minutes for rebuttal when we're done.
All right, thank you.
Good morning, Your Honors, and may it please the Court. I'd like to begin by clarifying one thing about the evidentiary record. Officestar presented no testimony to rebut. They had no expert to rebut Mr. Anders' testimony as to functionality, and the Court excluded as inadmissible, lacking any foundation, the offered testimony of Josh Blumenthal when he sought to opine on certain functions of the chair.
And so, none of those are issues on appeal.
No, not at all. But I'd like to step back to address a more fundamental issue that is lacking. I hope we don't need to go too deeply into the weeds as to the facts concerning the Eames chair, the one with the ribbed backing, because the jury has already made its determination.
I do have a question on the Eames chair, as long as you bring it up.
All right.
How do you defend the dilution damages?
If I may,
but you want to let him defend them?
Exactly.
Good.
Right.
That's it. Let him. We'll wait. We'll wait.
Okay. I'm glad he'll have an
That's
opportunity.
That's the problem.
As to both designs, the first and most fundamental question, which the law requires under the statute itself, Section 1052E of the Lanham Act, you must look at the whole. You must look at the whole of the design to assess functionality. And there's not a word of testimony or evidence presented by the defendants, in this case by Blumenthal, that the whole of either design was functional. Our expert, Mr. Anders, did walk through several of the individual features because an analytical approach of Blumenthal here was to try to dissect the chair into individual features. And even in that respect, Mr. Anders' unrebutted testimony was that there were numerous alternative ways to do each of the features as well as the whole. We presented innumerable examples of other task seating chairs, task chairs, or desk chairs, that was unrebutted. And under the disc golf test, that was obviously essential evidence the jury should have considered, and at least in the Eames case, did consider. But what would it even be to look at? Let's say it's just ask the question to look at the whole of this design. And we cited, for example, the Volkswagen Beetle as just a familiar example. But with respect to chairs, we know there are differences between folding chairs and stacking chairs and lounge chairs and desk chairs and benches and so forth. But Blumenthal or Officestar never even crossed that first threshold of saying what was the function of the overall chair that it contended it needed to copy. And so
I'm not sure I understand that argument.
That you need to look at.
We all understand what the function of a chair is.
Correct.
It is to be sat upon.
And there are different functions for stacking chairs and folding chairs and desk chairs.
Well, these are office chairs. Do they really have to come in with proof that people buy office chairs in order to sit in them in offices?
Well, to take back, you asked Mr. Dillard the question about whether if all of the features were functional and you didn't define what was functional, would the resulting whole potentially be non-functional and be protectable trade dress? If you look at the case that where that line of reasoning begins, the Leatherman case, what the court there first did was analyze each of the features of this folding multi-tool and say each one of those features was de jure functional. This court, by the way, has never rejected the distinction between de jure and de facto functionality. I can come to explain why that had absolutely nothing to do with the traffics case, which was very narrow in focus. But if you're going to even consider the question whether you can dissect a product design into constituent features, then you, according to Leatherman, at a minimum you should require that each of those individual features be de jure functional, not simply de facto functional. And maybe it is impossible to answer the question, what is the overall function of a chair that needed to be copied? I agree. It is simply to be sat in.
Could I ask a question about why the district court ruled on the Aeron secondary meaning issue? Because once the jury had found the Aeron functionality ruling, I don't understand why it mattered for the district court to rule on secondary meaning.
Well, I can speculate that perhaps Judge Kronstadt entertained some doubts as to the jury instruction and did agree with us at the very least. Yes, if this court affirms on functionality, it is of no ultimate importance.
So the idea is, if you win on the jury instruction and we remand, the only issue that would need to be retried is functionality, because secondary meaning is already resolved.
Well, not only functionality, but infringement.
Why should we? Let's assume we buy your argument about the instruction and we remand. Shouldn't we remand for a retrial of the whole Aeron case?
That's fine with us.
We shouldn't let the judge piecemeal in a previous case where he didn't need to make a ruling. A legal ruling for the next trial.
That is entirely acceptable to us, Your Honors. So,
interesting. I thought you'd say they hadn't appealed that, and so it's.
I would say that if you look at
our
rules,
I would say to you they couldn't appeal it because it's not part of the judgment.
Yeah, well,
it kind of is though. Which this is why my question. I mean, the judge ruled on it and made it one of the things that he said in the judgment.
And there's scarcely a word about this. They addressed it in their reply brief, but not in their opening brief.
But not even in the sense of saying it needs to be vacated because it was an advisory opinion or anything like that.
I'm not encouraging you to reverse Judge Kronstadt on that issue, but we would be delighted to have another opportunity with a proper jury instruction. And
tell us why. Let's assume the jury instruction on the Aeron chair. It was the same instruction given on the Eames chair, but no, they're not complaining about it. You're not complaining about it. My question is, why was that harmful error in this case?
Your Honors, I think, have already articulated it. We can't discern.
And by the way, they're not arguing that it was harmless error.
No, they don't address it at all.
But I'm asking you that question.
If you even you address the second part of the second and the third objectionable sentences. Even before that, if you look at the first one, the jury instruction begins by making a false dichotomy that a feature is either essential to the use or purpose of the article or makes no contribution at all. Now, we have found no precedent that supports that position, and as the court has acknowledged, it's difficult, if not impossible, to find a product that meets that standard. And then you turn to the next two, and those are aesthetic functionality instructions that just don't belong in this case. Mr. Dillard acknowledged, and there's never been a dispute, this case does not concern aesthetic functionality. It does concern, by the way, which makes this a particularly important case, two of the most iconic pieces of furniture in the world.
I think this may not matter because he has said it's not an aesthetic functionality case and everyone seems to be operating on that. But can you just explain that to me? Because it seems like kind of what you are arguing is the combination is aesthetically pleasing and that's the value the customer wants. And so why isn't this an aesthetic functionality?
Well, I can actually make that point most interestingly about perhaps the Aeron chair in which Your Honor is sitting, that when this chair was first launched, it was criticized as looking like an insect. It has grown in popularity to be the best-selling piece of furniture ever. Sits in the Los Angeles County Museum of Art, MoMA in New York.
But that's because people think it is aesthetically pleasing, right? And so why isn't it an aesthetic? I mean, maybe you win the aesthetic functionality inquiry, right. But I'm a little bit confused how we decide whether a case is an aesthetic functionality case or not.
Well, in this instance, that's a very good question, and I'm not certain I know how to answer that, except that aesthetic functionality is a very dubious doctrine that has been wildly criticized. I know this court, I'm not sure if in this courthouse, but there's a case called Redbubble that's coming up soon that challenges whether aesthetic functionality should be dispensed with entirely.
But you dispensed with it entirely in this case.
Yes.
Nobody's making an aesthetic functionality claim. So if they're not, I'm trying to figure out why the notion, what is it that makes this distinctive?
So what I will say, and I can
this chair. What is it that makes this chair distinctive? It's not, if not its aesthetics.
It has acquired so many fans. Even in The Simpsons, God sits in an Aeron chair. When we walked into the courtroom this morning, from sitting in the gallery, I could see just about the top 3 or 4 inches of your chair and the bailiff's chair. I knew immediately, just from that bulbous shape, the very top, what the chair was, and it brought to mind more than 30 years ago when I took my oldest daughter to Disneyland, when you approach and you can see the ears of Mickey, first just little tiny slivers, and then they grow. But as soon as you see those first two slivers, you know what it is. People know what this chair is because it has acquired such enormous renown. And it's that renown, not just that it's quirky or inherently beautiful, or maybe not beautiful, it's distinctive.
Do you think more so than the Eames? I'm a little bit confused how the jury came up with the verdict the way it did. It might have been expected to be the opposite.
I am I'm reminded that I should try to wrap this up to allow Mr. Ciardullo to speak. But it is a puzzle to us, I confess. The Eames chair, there was testimony that whatever functionality it had, and bearing in mind aesthetic functionality was not argued, but whatever aesthetic functionality it functionality it had was based on notions that have long since become outdated from the 1950s when Charles and Ray Eames designed it. So that it is now, it is just simply an icon of mid-century modern design.
Maybe, I was trying to figure out the same thing. It may be that the success of your expert's testimony in the Eames chair meant that you lost on the Aeron chair, because the kinds of things he said about the Eames chair didn't apply to the Aeron chair.
Well, that's why we need a second trial, so that the jury can properly assess.
They don't hear what he said before. Right?
Well, no. I guess I can't win on that. But that the jury can properly assess with a proper jury instruction what the test is. This court has never disavowed the disc golf factors. Traffics was a very narrow case. It involved a simple question, what is the weight to be given to subject matter that is literally claimed in a utility patent? That's not an issue here. The Supreme Court.
I need to remind you that your co-counsel is now frantically writing down things on pieces of paper. It's your call, but
the Supreme Court began and ended the traffics case by saying we recognize that there is a right to trade dress protection under the trademark statute, and the test or the theories that they are proposing would be the death knell, to quote Automotive Gold, in this case. So again, thank you.
Constructive notice. That's
you.
Okay.
Right. So,
well, you throw the short straw at everything, huh?
Thank you.
And maybe in the break, I should just say I'm too short for that chair, which is why I have this chair. Otherwise, my feet are up in the air. So, no, nothing intended by the fact that I'm too short for the big chairs.
Good morning, Your Honors. May it please the court. My name is Jean-Paul Trudillo. I'm from Foley and Lardner, appearing on behalf of Herman Miller, primarily to discuss issues of willfulness and damages, which would include notice issues, and given the limited time, my intent had been to discuss matters that were raised in Office Star's reply brief, which
Let me tell you the first thing I'd like you to address, since I tried to ask your colleague about that and he ducked it. Dilution damages with respect to the Eames chair.
Yes.
The case law seems to say you got to be really famous in order to qualify for dilution damages. And I'm a cyclist, and I know Trek bicycles don't qualify, even though they were on TV all the time with Lance Armstrong standing next to them and claiming that it was them and not whatever drugs he was taking that made him fast. So why does the Herman Miller chair, why is it sufficiently famous to give rise to dilution damages?
Well, Your Honor, I think to frame the question, it would be, did the jury have a reasonable basis based on the evidence to find
them? Well, except we held in the Trek case holds as a matter of law that the combination of factors in this case was not enough to go to the jury. So why did you have enough evidence to go to the jury on famousness here?
Well, unlike the example that was given by Office Star of a computer program that had been downloaded 20 million times just in the past 18 months or so, this chair has been around since the 1950s.
So forget the example they gave. Deal with Trek.
Yes.
Tell me why you're more famous than Trek.
The evidence at trial showed that this chair is something that's used ubiquitously in our culture. It's on television. It's in the movies. It's in communal seating areas where people who don't even own it sit in it. So any one chair may have been viewed by or sat in by thousands and thousands of people. It's something that is immediately recognizable, as the evidence showed, to a large number of people. And it's important to understand that many of these cases dealing with fame and dilution may concern word marks, and they're concerning top of mind of, do they recognize a brand name? Here, this is purely concerned with the look, and trade dress does not require knowing who made it. And the evidence that was presented in terms of the amount of sales, the way in which these chairs are used, how often they're seen by people in settings, the length of time that they've been around, there was an enormous amount of evidence from which a jury could infer that...
Now, we're talking now only about the Eames chair, because obviously you didn't get a jury verdict on the Aeron chair.
Yes.
And so do you think the Eames chair is one of those things that's famous among members of the general consuming public? This one, I might agree. But the Eames chair, is that really famous among the public at large?
I would say it is, Your Honor.
In the Simpsons, he's sitting in this one, by the way.
Well, it's, and again, the question is whether the jury had a reasonable basis. I understand your distinction.
Well, no, because Trek seemed to say, look, let's not, the jury's, you know, we're not going to send this to the jury unless it's a case in which the evidence is of a select class of marks, those that are truly prominent, renowned. And it has to be, and we said it's not going to just be a niche market, it has to be the general consuming public, which seems to me to suggest that it's the public that buys things, not just the public that looks at things. So I'm having trouble figuring out why the Eames chair, which I didn't recognize when I first looked at it, fits in that sort of category.
Again, I think that the evidence that was presented in terms of the sales, the millions and millions of dollars been spent on marketing the chair over the years.
So is the marketing more than the marketing spent on the track? I see. I try to compare the numbers, and in all those sort of measurable respects, the Trek bicycle had more advertising, more sales, more TV. So what is it that let us get to the notion that this one is more famous?
Well, I'd also bring it back to the law and the jury instruction that was applied, which was a set of factors defined by the statute. There was no error assigned to this jury instruction, and it was presented to the jury without any objection. And the jury was presented with facts that addressed the factors, and they reached a certain conclusion.
Included that it was known by the general public, because that's what they needed to find, right? That's what the jury instructions track that.
I don't have the exact language, but yes, I believe that's exactly right. Seeing I have very limited time, I wonder if I might...
Can you speak to the constructive notice issue, how we're supposed to deal with unregistered trade dress?
So the law is very clear that we cite in the brief. If you have trade dress that is unregistered, there's no requirement to have placed a R with a circle on it. And if that's what Your Honor is asking,
well,
are you asking about
the... I'm not sure it's so clear. I mean, the statute says that if you have a registered trademark, then you need to give notice. But so what happens if you have both registered and unregistered? I actually don't think it's so clear what we're supposed to think of the statute at that point.
We have cited case law, and it's in that section of the brief, that's pretty clear that if you have unregistered trade dress, there's no requirement to mark anything. And it's not an unfair result, because the evidentiary burdens for registered and unregistered, if you come in with a registered trademark, you're kind of running the table because you have presumptions of evidence in your favor. If you're coming in with unregistered, you're at a disadvantage in having to establish validity in the first instance. So it's not an unfair
distinction. Let's assume you're wrong. Let's assume that some sort of notice is required. I'm trying to sort out the jury verdict in this case. The jury was instructed, I think, that it had to find either constructive or actual notice, was it not?
Yes.
And they didn't make a separate jury interrogatory on that, right?
No.
So their verdict was in favor of you with respect to the Eames chair. What does that tell us they found? One of the two? Both of the two? How do we interpret that jury verdict?
It could have been either. And in fact, one of the cases that we
cite... So do we view that verdict in the light most favorable to the prevailing party?
Yes, Your Honor. It's one of the two cases we cited in relation to the dilution damages amount that...
So you don't need to argue that no notice is required because the jury found that there was actual notice.
I would think that's correct. And what I was going to say is that
or constructive notice, and that's enough, you think?
Either one, I think, would have been sufficient. The actual notice the jury could found, we had enormous amounts of evidence that Office Star knew of the chair and deliberately adopted the design because they knew it was popular. They were involved in trade dress litigation of their own, familiar with the issues, warned of infringement by their
customers. No, there
was
plenty of information. I'm trying to figure out the effect of the jury verdict because the jury found that there was either constructive or actual. Assume for a moment, for purposes of the argument, that constructive isn't enough. Now I'm trying to figure out, do we infer from the jury verdict that they found actual?
I would say yes, Your Honor.
Why?
Well, because of all the evidence that was submitted that Office Star was...
But there's plenty of evidence of constructive notice, too. So I'm just trying to figure out what weight I can give to the jury verdict, which was an or. Does that tell me they had actual notice, or just tell me they had either constructive or actual? You don't think it makes
I think
a difference,
it would be either.
But maybe it does.
At page 54 of our opening brief, we cite the two cases that deal with this issue in a slightly different context in terms of parsing on which basis did the jury reach its result, and the answer was that it doesn't matter. They reached the result that they did, and we're not allowed to inquire further we're not allowed to piece it apart and say, well, they didn't have a basis under this rationale. If that's what Your Honor is
suggesting.
No,
I'm saying I assume for purposes of my question that they could have found either constructive notice or actual notice or both. And I'm assuming also for purposes of my question that this is very easy if they had actual notice. If it was only constructive notice, I don't know how easy it is. But you said we don't need it. So I'm trying to figure out what I can infer from the jury verdict, that they had actual notice, that they had constructive notice, or I can't tell which of the two they had.
I think it would be the last thing you said, and that is but still sufficient for the ruling, the verdict to be upheld.
So basically, is your argument that all you need to show is that they found at least that there was constructive notice, and is that of the registered trade dress?
My argument would have been that it's at least that they found actual notice, and ultimately this issue of the constructive
notice of which kind, the registered or unregistered?
Of either one. I think that there was...
The same damages as to both, right?
Yes, Your Honor.
Yeah, so it's not double damages.
Frankly, we view the issue of the registration as a bit of a red herring because with unregistered trade dress not needing the R with the circle, it became a moot point. It would only have been relevant if the jury had parsed and said that the unregistered trade dress was not protectable and only the registered trade dress was. But since they found the unregistered trade dress protectable, the issue of the R with the circle became moot. And frankly, it's not really relevant in our view.
So then, on your view, you don't need notice of anything.
Actual notice, which we think that there was more than enough.
But I thought you said it for the unregistered trade dress, you don't need notice of anything.
You don't need notice of the R. You don't need the R with circle, is what I was trying to convey.
Okay. So what do you need notice of?
You need notice of that the plaintiff had rights, was claiming trade dress rights, and not having a willful blindness to the fact that they might be.
But your position, I take it, is that because there was sufficient evidence to support constructive or actual notice with respect to the registered mark, we don't need to worry about the unregistered mark.
To articulate my argument, I think more precisely, I was trying to say that because the jury found that the unregistered trademark rights were valid, there was no need to inquire into whether or not the registered...
Yeah, let me rephrase that.
Could you just finish what you were going to say about... You were getting to say that the unregistered trade dress needs to have some kind of constructive... constructive notice, I think is what you were starting to say, and I just wanted you to finish because I don't think I understood that part.
I don't know if I'd use the word constructive, but what I would have said that, you know, we would have said that the proof that we submitted in the case that Office Star, in fact, had a suspicion, should have had a very reasonable suspicion that we had trademark rights, was more than amply shown, and that should be sufficient to carry the day.
But you're saying they should have known that you had unregistered trade dress rights.
Yes, and
at what time, like when do they need to have had that? Either actual constructive notice of the idea that you would have unregistered trade dress rights.
It would apply as to the whole point of this inquiry is pre-suit damages. So it would apply as to cover any period of before the suit from which they had the knowledge.
So it's like 2010. They need to have had at least constructive notice of unregistered trade dress rights as of 2010.
To claim damages back that far. I mean, if the evidence were to show that they had it by 2011, then that's when the damages period would begin.
But wasn't it 2010 here?
The chairs were introduced, I believe, at the very end of 2010. I can't remember if they ultimately ended up going on sale maybe at the last month of 2010.
Have you finished?
Well, yeah, I mean, I just am a little bit confused because I thought your brief had said that for unregistered trade dress, no notice was required. But now it seems like you're saying there is a requirement of notice, but it was satisfied. It seems like a shift, and maybe I misunderstood. I didn't need to go back to your brief, but I'm just trying to make sure I understand what your position is.
I believe that our position had been that with respect to the...
Unregistered.
Yeah, the R symbol. This is what it was with respect to using the R, and that if you have unregistered trade dress, there's no requirement of using the R with the circle.
Right, that's, which I thought was an argument that you didn't need any sort of notice, but maybe I just misunderstood what you meant.
We made it only in the context that I just said.
Okay, but I want to understand this again. The award of infringement damages with respect to the Eames chair, there are not separate awards for infringement of the registered and unregistered dress, correct?
Correct, Your Honor.
It's one single award.
One award.
And so we don't need to worry about what kind of notice is required for the unregistered dress if we were hypothetically to uphold the jury award with respect to the registered dress.
That sounds correct to me, Your Honor.
Yeah, you're not arguing that we had X amount of damages on unregistered and X amount of damages on registered. You're saying our total damages from the infringement was X.
Correct. Well, and to just put a more finer point on what you just said, the profits to proxy is just supposed to be a rough estimate. The evidence showed that...
It's a separate issue of the amount. I'm just saying it really doesn't matter what notice is required for the unregistered dress if we find there was sufficient notice for the registered dress.
I would think that's correct, Your Honor.
Yeah, we may or may not find that, but we don't need to get to the second question if we resolve the first one in your favor.
Yes. I appreciate that we're over. There were a couple things I had wanted to say.
Yeah, but that's why I warned you at the beginning what splitting leads to, and it leads to going home with things you wanted to say but couldn't. So I'm going to give you a couple minutes for rebuttal.
Thank you, Your Honor. With respect to the last issue, it appears to me that with respect to the unregistered rights, that the damage period would be whenever actual construction or actual notice was given. If there's a registration and you use the circle R, that provides constructive notice.
But you think constructive notice is not enough with respect to the unregistered dress?
Yes. I'm sorry.
Is constructive notice enough to start triggering the damages period with respect to the unregistered dress?
I don't believe so, Your Honor.
And would notice look like? It's the cease and desist letter?
Oh, yes.
And so the only way to give notice, in your view, the only way to give notice of unregistered dress is to send a letter saying you're copying my product.
Well, there's more to it than just copying the product, because you have to explain what you're claiming to have trade dress in.
But
that's the event. Now, with respect to the circle R, Herman Miller argued that the hang tag on the Eames chair which is reproduced on page 22 of our brief, where it has Eames, little tiny circle R chair, is enough notice of the registration for the trade dress, in addition to the fact that the word Eames was registered. So,
wasn't there a substantial amount of evidence in this case about what your clients knew and when they knew it to sort of do the Howard Baker analysis? There were lots of statements saying,
right,
you know, this is just like the Herman Miller chair, and we got to be careful, and you know, and things like that. Isn't that circumstantial evidence from which notice could have been inferred?
Well, that's circumstantial evidence of, you know, perhaps copying, or the somebody thinking the desirability of features that might have been on the Eames chair. But, you know, a desire to copy is not the same as a desire to trade off somebody's goodwill. You have to understand and know what the trade dress is, and then your actions have to be copying for the purpose of trading off the goodwill. And there's circumstantial evidence that, there was evidence that Officer never used Herman Miller or Eames, that they have their own brand names for these products, and never suggested that that their products were associated with or came from Herman Miller. So you know, I think given the circumstances, the triggering event should have been the cease and desist letter. Okay.
I'll let you go to 2 minutes.
Yeah. Okay. So there's just a couple of things that I hope you could consider. With respect to this functionality again and the disc factors, disc golf factors, you've got utilitarian advantage, advertising, available alternatives, and manufacturing. With a utilitarian advantage, you're looking at what the functional things were. Well, the evidence, and this is reported throughout the order, I guess, denying our motion for JNOV, but the evidence was that so many of these components performed a function but also provided aesthetics. And let's face it, anything that's visible is going to be contributing to the aesthetics. So the fact that it contributes to the aesthetics does not mean it's non-functional. Then with advertising, another factor in the disc golf, that shouldn't be weighed. I mean, just like the utilitarian, it's not a weighing that the aesthetics is more important to the function, or if it performs a function, if it contributes to the function, provides some functionality, then it's functional. And then it's the burden would be on Herman Miller to show what aspects of those components are non-functional. With advertising, if you advertise that something or the functional attributes of something, you know, that's evidence of functionality, even if there's a whole bunch of advertising that is purely on the aesthetics, because
let me ask you to wrap up, because
okay.
we've given both sides extra time.
Thank you, Your Honor.
I thank both sides for both their arguments and their briefs in this very interesting case. That ends today's sitting, and we'll recess until tomorrow.
All rise. This court for this session stands adjourned.